All right, tell me when we're on live, because I don't want to be, talking as if we're not on live when we are already. So don't mess me up.
Sorry, we're about to be
live. Give me a
in
clear
five,
signal.
Four,
four.
Oh, we're three. Live.
Wait, when are we gonna be live? Oh, come on, man!
Surprise!
Hi, I'm Cy Kellett, host of Catholic Answers Live, which will begin in about 15 minutes, a little more than 15 minutes. This is Carlo Broussard. He's an apologist here at Catholic Answers, author of this book, Prepare the Way.
Mais bonjour.
We used to do this thing called Catholic Answers More, where we would just have conversations for the folks that join us online. And we got away from doing it because... Well,
you
I don't
dropped
talk,
the ball,
I don't want to
son.
Talk about why. We,
you well, dropped the ball.
But the ball has been picked up by Marie, our new assistant
Woo-hoo!
Producer. Is that the correct title, Marie? Assistant producer? Okay.
That's pretty fancy.
Because I never know, oh, she's saying hello. Okay. And so now we're back to doing Catholic Answers More. And the first one we were able to schedule was with Carlo today at 3 on the live radio show. Carlo's going to be talking about why it matters to be Catholic. And so we'll get to that. But Carlo, you and I both live far away from here, and we both have a nasty commute.
Indeed. How many miles is it for you?
Well, it's only 37 miles.
It's 65 miles for me.
But my 37 miles, I can't do those 37 miles in less than about an hour and 5 minutes. That's the best I do.
I can't do my 65 miles less than an hour and 40.
Holy smokes, Carlo. I just feel so much better now.
An hour and 40 minute day? That's a good day, bro.
But I have a very simple solution to this.
Okay.
Listen
to Carlo Broussard talks.
when I'm driving, yes, listen to Carlo Broussard talks. Your truth, my truth.
That's right. That's the audio version. The audio product.
Yeah.
And then also, too, Bible Blueprint for the Mass, Bible
Blueprint for the priesthood. I got right here somewhere. I don't know where I put it. But.
And maybe one of these days we'll get creative and maybe do some kind of like audio book or something, right? Wouldn't that be cool?
Look, Why God Still Matters.
That's the DVD.
That's a DVD, though.
You can't listen to that one unless you know how to extract the audio or something.
That's funny that you would think that I could even do. But here's my solution to this. Very, very simple solution.
All right.
Catholic Answers is in El Cajon. We both live north of here by a long shot.
I think I know where you're going with that.
Just move Catholic Answers, say 40 or 50 miles north.
Indeed.
There's a city there.
All you got to do.
It's called Escondido.
All you got to do is go across, and all I got to do is go down halfway.
Now, that will increase Nick's commute.
That's right. But that's okay, because Nick really doesn't matter.
Oh, but Nick.
I love you, brother. Don't worry, man.
Nick could probably use the drive, you know, the practice driving and all that kind of thing. He just got his license. He's all so what do you think? Just move the whole apostolate to Escondido. Just you and I, it'll be halfway between us.
Amen to that, brother. Everybody will have equal driving distance.
But here's the thing, and I've been thinking about this because I have come to realize that my time as a commuter is pretty much wasted.
Really?
Yeah. And I don't feel happy about that. I'm thinking, look, this is like 10 hours a week. This can be used much more productively. It's not totally wasted, but I don't have good habits about using that time. And I know you, Carlo Broussard, have good habits about that. You don't waste your, whatever it is, 40 hours a week.
No,
in
I must
traffic.
Say I don't.
So,
but it's not hard for me not to waste it.
But as a philosopher, you have learned, and I've actually heard you say this, that habits are the things that are performative in our lives. Anybody can do something once or twice, but it's the habits. You know, good habits make for a better life than bad habits.
Amen to that.
You say it like it's so easy, which apparently for you it is. But like, you're very good at studying. That's something you're really good at.
Yeah, I mean, I must say I am, but I don't have to try at it. Like, I've never, it's never been a problem for me or a hurdle or an obstacle for me to have to really make myself study, unless there's like some like cool Marvel show or something and I need to study and I can't watch the Marvel comic show or something, then I'm kind of like bummed, you know.
See, I can find almost any excuse not to study.
Yeah. I mean, I must say it is difficult.
And study is different than just reading.
Yeah.
Like, study is a different thing. And you study when you're in the car.
I do. There is not a moment in my drive when I am not listening to something. If I'm not listening, it's in a moment of silence, but that's because I'm contemplating what I just heard. So see, it's either a lecture, yeah, like an audible lecture that I listen to, but more so I listen to journal articles. So I have an awesome app. I don't know if we're like supposed to advertise on here.
No, it's okay to talk about, because that's actually what I want to know, because okay, I got to make better use of my time.
So there's this cool app. It's the best $15 I've ever spent. It's called VoiceDream.
All right, where's my phone? Oh, I left it
yeah,
up.
Yeah, and it's for iPhone and, you know, Android. But what it does is it reads Word docs, it reads PDF files, mm-hmm, it can read any article you find online. So if you go online, you find an article you like,
yeah,
and you just press save, and then it saves it into the app, mm-hmm, and then it reads the article.
Tell me the name of it again, I'm sorry.
VoiceDream. But what's really cool, Si, is that for a while I was using, like, for the Kindle voice, mm-hmm, the robotic voice for Kindle, where you just swipe and it reads the ebook for you. And that's okay. But this robotic voice in VoiceDream is, like, phenomenal. Like, I do not, when I'm listening, I don't even notice
but
that
it's a robot.
Where the sentences, you know, the periods, the paragraph breaks, it's just phenomenal at how natural it is. And then, of course, you can adjust your speed.
Can I ask you something? Were you just about to call the robot he?
Because it is a male voice.
Yeah, that's so funny. Because that is going to be, digress for just a moment on that, that's going to become harder and harder in the coming decades to distinguish between a real human and a robot. And then people, I think, we're very tactile creatures. And if you sound like a human being, or if you look like a human being, or if you can imitate, we're going to end up very confused. Don't you think?
You mean
society?
Like, you mean like marrying computers and
stuff,
like in that movie, Her?
Oh yeah, people are definitely going to go in that direction.
Yeah, yeah. But it is phenomenal. And
this
so this
VoiceDream,
this VoiceDream app has been a tremendous benefit for me in being able to utilize 3 hours of my day when I commute, because an hour in the morning from 4:30 to 5:30,
yeah,
and then pretty much 2 hours in the afternoon as I'm going home, to actually utilize those 3 hours for the good and for the benefit of my own formation as an apologist, as a philosopher, a theologian, et cetera, whatever you want to call it. However, I will say this. It is unfortunate. I would prefer to have those 3 hours of intense reading of the docs that I'm reading, because my learning capacity in that vein, right, of listening to an article while driving, right? I mean, it cuts it probably about half, you know, precisely because of the constant distractions, you know, of having to focus on driving, right?
Yeah.
And then also, too, just not being able to see the text and not having that spatial awareness on the page.
Right.
And seeing, you know, so you're only utilizing just that one sense, the sense of hearing, in order to assimilate the information, so it cuts your learning capacity greatly. However, it is 3 hours used wisely,
right,
you know. And what helps me is that if I ever come up to a question that I can't answer or I need some help answering, I'll remember, oh yeah, I remember that article I listened to, and then I go and pull it up and actually read it and assimilate the argument,
right,
so that I can utilize it, you know? And that's happened several times. I come to a point, like, for example, I'm writing my thesis right now for my master's in philosophy, and I've listened to several journal articles already related to the topic of my thesis. But now that I'm writing my thesis, I can go back to those articles and really read them in depth in order to assimilate it and try to utilize it in my thesis.
What about writing while driving? Have you ever tried that? Because you can talk.
I actually do that.
Dragon or something like that?
What's Dragon?
It's a program for changing your speech to text.
Really?
Yeah.
Ooh, I'm going to have to see. You taught me something. I'm going to look into that. Dragon?
Yeah.
Because
I can't do it, though. I struggle with it a lot while driving to be able to think in the way that's necessary to write.
Oh, really? Interesting. Yeah. Because that's not an obstacle for me. So what happens is as I'm listening to the article, I'll make voice memos. So I have two forms. I do an audio. I can do either an audio voice memo and say, you know, this page, this article, here's the idea.
Yeah.
Sometimes, though, what I came to realize is that it takes time to translate that audio into text and save it in my files. So what I do is I just use the notes function on the iPhone, and then it does voice to text. And so I'll speak a note related to what I just heard in the journal article or whatever, right?
Right.
But the problem is that it has a hard time reading my accent, you know. I talk like a Cajun man, and they just don't understand it.
Well, talk like you're in here, because you always talk so clearly when you're on the air.
I have to try to really enunciate my words so that it can pick up what I'm trying to say. So sometimes I'll go back to the note and I'll try to read it. Like, what the heck?
Yeah, I've done that where
it's pointless, you know,
because I didn't hear what I said. But,
right.
So I think I could do that. I mean, I can take notes. But I can't, like, if I have a talk, I've thought this before. Okay, you're going to be in the car for like an hour.
Right.
Take this week and just
generate the thoughts.
You know, generate, And I get too distracted. It's very hard for me.
That's one of the ways that I collect a queue of blog ideas.
Oh.
So when an idea pops up, I'll do a voice memo and just think it out loud. You know, think through the idea of what I might write about. And even for my talks, if I'm preparing for a talk and I'm trying to organize my points, if an idea sparks, you know, if an idea is generated, I'll put it in the voice memo, you know, so that I can go back to it. And that helps because, man, I'll have a great idea.
Yeah.
And if I do not put
it
in.
Look who's trying to be on the internet. Did you see that? It was so.
Star Rider!
Like, I want to be on the internet.
And so if I don't save it, it's happened several times. I have a great idea and I don't save it. And just like literally an hour later, and I'm like, man, what did I think about?
Yeah.
I missed it.
Right.
It's gone now, you know?
Yeah, I used to carry the Moleskine. Do you know what a Moleskine book is?
No. That's those little
books that don't tear apart. They don't, you know, and they are very flat.
Yeah. Put it in your pocket.
But I you know what I do a lot is I will write notes to myself about things that I either need to do or that I'm going to write about or something on receipts. Like I always feel like, well, I got a receipt in my pocket. I just write it on the receipt. And so actually, I think my wife doesn't throw away the receipt. She doesn't touch my stuff because you never know what weird thing I'm doing with it.
Like, right.
Wait, you threw away that Walgreens receipt? I had the beginnings of a novel on that.
I actually was turned on to that, whatever you call it, Moleskine notebooks by my undergrad professor, Dr. Tim Gray from Augustine Institute.
Yeah.
He would advise us students to use that, and he would say often how many the books he's written has stemmed from
Moleskine
notes that he's making. But for me, it doesn't work because, number one, I can't write while I'm driving, right? I tried it, but I never got into it.
Yeah.
You know? It just never clicked for me. So precisely because you always have to carry it around, you know, like a wallet or something.
So, this brings me back around to that idea of habits though, that I have to consciously now change my habit because for years I did not have a commute. And okay. So over the last 17 months that I've been here, it has started to be like, okay, like it's dawning on me, this is a lot of time that is not
that's going by
being productively employed. So how do you go about changing a habit like that for you? I mean, I know you're a Superman and you can just be like, I must do this. I will become Arnold Schwarzenegger. I don't know. Arnold Schwarzenegger sounded like Colonel Klink there. Sorry about that.
Yeah, my only suggestion would be just find something you really like to listen to.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, pick a topic or a question that been bugging you and go do some research. Try to find some articles online or a lecture online that seeks to address that issue.
Yeah.
And then that way your interest is piqued, so your attention is ordered toward it.
And I'm ready to go.
Yeah, because what happens for me is a lot of times I'll just put on an article and let it go, you know, like just something that's not pertinent to what I'm studying right now.
Yeah.
But I just do it for the sake of training. And so I'll put it on. But if I'm not looking for the information, I have a hard time paying attention.
I see.
It just goes in one ear, out the other, you know?
I was thinking of getting an Audible copy of, have you read the book, A Secular Age? The philosopher Charles Taylor's book,
No.
Secular Age. It's on how we became secular, I guess. Okay. So maybe I'll try that one. Because I think I would be interested in that.
There you go.
That or maybe... We got 40 seconds? Is that music playing out there? Were you thinking that this kind of music would... This is Cuban music. This has nothing to do with Carlos' heritage, if that's what you were thinking.
That's some good stuff,
well,
man.
It's all south. It's all down there south of us.
That's some groovy music right there, though.
I got it. So 40 seconds, and then what? We're going to have a timeout for the EWTN connection, and we'll be quiet. We'll have 10 seconds. All right, I better get my Celtics shirt off.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and a wonderful Wednesday for you. Second hour, we're going to be talking about what I think is one of the most pressing things that Christians need to be talking about today, and that is a movement called, generally speaking, by people who are not in it themselves, the prosperity gospel. We'll talk about what that has to do with the gospel of Jesus Christ, if anything, and what we need to be attentive to about that with Lisa Cooper. Lisa was raised in Word of Faith Church, which is a prosperity gospel movement, and she's just a wonderful resource on that. So if you've come up against this and you'd like some help in understanding what we're dealing with here and what is the appropriate Catholic Christian response, you're going to love that hour. This hour, we talk about why you should bother being Catholic at all. Why is it important to be Catholic? From different people's perspectives, there might be different questions, and that question might be phrased differently from the non-Christian person who might say, why bother even with religion at all? And specifically, why would I bother attending to the Catholic Church? The non-Catholic Christian, of which there are many, millions and millions of non-Catholic Christians who look at the Catholic Church and say, why? Why would that be something I would need to be connected to or involved in, and many Catholics who maybe are lukewarm or have not been properly catechized and educated about what it means to be Catholic and why stay. All those questions are welcome. 888-318-7884. If you'd like to discuss why in the world bother to be Catholic, give us a call. 888-318-7884. Our guest for that discussion is Carlo Broussard, and Carlo is here in studio with me. Carlo is apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of the wonderful book, Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church, which I am holding up for our internet participants. We just had a really nice pre-show chat with internet folks, and thanks for being here, Carlo.
Oh, you're welcome, Si. It's always great, man.
So you think that there's an answer for each of these different groups? Like, we can actually say to people, hey, here's why it's important that you be Catholic.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, so you brought out the idea of a non-Christian saying, well, it doesn't really matter to be a Catholic because, you know, all religions are pretty much the same, right? So this idea of religious pluralism. Well, any just cursory examination of the various beliefs of the various religions will show that they're not all the same. I mean, Christianity teaches Jesus is God, the very reason why we exist, the one whom we must bow down and worship. Non-Christian religions say he's not God. So one of them's got to be right and the other one's got to be wrong, right? So they're essentially not the same, you know? So, and then you can go on down the list of beliefs about the afterlife and about the nature of the human being and about the nature of the transcendent, you know? And, you know, maybe there is something transcendent in these various religions, but the nature of that transcendent reality is going to vary according to the various beliefs of those religions. So all religions are not the same. And even just the statement that it doesn't matter, it assumes or it presupposes that truth doesn't really matter, or any sort of truth revealed by God doesn't really matter. If God did reveal himself through a particular religion, we as Christians would say through his son Jesus Christ, and the Christian religion is the fullness of that revelation, well, then it would matter, right? Because the infinite reality is communicating himself to humanity, so that particular religion would matter. So that's how I would begin to construct a response to a non-Christian who is saying, well, it doesn't really matter which religion you belong to. That tells me that individual has not really carefully looked in to the various claims of religion. Now, you can also encounter an individual who's a non-Catholic Christian, right? So like a Protestant. And those individuals would say, well, it doesn't really matter if you're Catholic or not, because as Christians, we're all the same, right?
Mm-hmm.
We all love Jesus. We all profess the Trinity. And that's really the only thing that really matters in this whole institutionalized, visible hierarchy of religion and stuff that the Catholic Church teaches is not really what Jesus intended. So we would have to respond to that particular claim and saying, yes, it is true that Catholics and non-Catholic Christians agree that Jesus is God and the Trinity, and those are, you know, the essential elements to be considered a Christian, validly baptized, incorporated into the mystical body of Christ. But Jesus taught us certain things about his Father and about the church that he established in this community of believers. And so Catholics and Protestants vary on those various teachings. And to say that doesn't matter is to say that truth doesn't matter, because these things that Jesus came to reveal to us from the Father are mysteries about reality itself.
Yeah.
You know, because the doctrines are not just some abstract ideas. The doctrines that Jesus taught, these teachings, express certain realities about himself and God and the relationship between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and the relationship with humanity and the people of God and the relationship with the church. So we have to take these things serious. These things do matter because Jesus revealed them to us. If they didn't matter, he wouldn't have taught us about these things. So we do need to roll up our sleeves and dialogue and figure out, hey, what did Jesus teach? And not just sweep those differences underneath the rug, but that we have to talk about the differences, even though we do have common ground more so than we do with other folks, right? So we have to keep in mind that doctrine matters, right? Mm. And so to that individual, I would say it matters to be a Catholic precisely because as you love Jesus and I love Jesus, right? If Jesus started the Catholic Church, if Jesus willed for us to have a universal shepherd guiding and leading the flock of God on earth, namely the Pope, well, then it would matter to be Catholic because that's a gift Jesus wills for us to have. Along down the line with the sacraments and the Eucharist and confession and confirmation, if Jesus came to give us all of these great gifts, gifts that he intends for us to share in and experience the joy in embracing the truth of these gifts, right? Well, then it would matter, you see?
Yeah.
And then, of course, that would be sort of a similar response to even a Catholic who might say, well, it doesn't really matter if you're Catholic or not because, you know, Protestants who are living good Christian lives, they don't need to become Catholic because they're just fine where they're at, right? And that it's possible for them to be saved. The church teaches that if they're not culpable for their ignorance of the truth of the Catholic faith, so why bother? But that gets back to the idea that the truth that fully subsists in the Catholic Church, as the Church teaches, and you know, its 2000 document Dominus Iesus, and has subsequently taught over and over again in the past, right? That the fullness of truth and life that Jesus came to reveal to us subsists in the Catholic Church. That truth is that which all people are made for. It is in that truth that human beings will find their happiness, find their joy, right?
Yes.
And so for us not to will that good for another either we don't see the grandeur aspect or how good that truth is,
right.
Or we're not loving the other person, right? One of the
right,
other.
Right, right.
So it's out of love that we would will for other people to become Catholic, because we know that the truth that Christ has invested in the Catholic Church matters, and therefore being Catholic matters.
888-318-7884 is our number. Carlo Bussard is our guest, and we're discussing why does it matter to be Catholic this hour on Catholic Answers Live. Why does it matter to be Catholic? If you've got questions in that regard, if you have challenges you want to present in that regard, 888-318-7884 is our number. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back with more Carlo Bussard and your calls after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hey everyone, Carlo Bussard here. Did you know that you can arrange for me and a host of other on-fire Catholic Answers speakers to speak at your conference or parish event? Here's how you do it. Go to CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com and you'll find all the information that you need to book me or our other great speakers. That's CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com. We look forward to seeing you.
Summer is upon us, and though the temperatures are going up, the prices are coming down during Catholic Answers' first ever summer book sale in the online shop at Catholic.com. For a limited time, dozens of great books are available for $10, $5, even as low as $1 a copy. This is the time to load up on solid Catholic books for you, your friends, and your family. The spectacular online event offers savings of 50% and more on books by Jimmy Akin, Tim Staples, Rod Bennett, Gary Machuda, and a whole host of esteemed authors, evangelists, and apologists. We've even got all of the books in our Catholic Answers Classics series marked down. Log on now to shop.catholic.com and take advantage of what will be one of the most exciting sales of the summer. You know it's all good stuff because it's from the people you know and trust at Catholic Answers. Log on to shop.catholic.com and start saving today.
Sharing the gospel with family and friends can be challenging. It's especially hard when they won't even hear you out because of all the mental roadblocks they've built up. This is Carlo Bussard, and in my new book, Prepare the Way, my aim is to help you tackle that essential first step to apologetics and evangelization, getting people to listen with an open mind. Even our best witness can bounce right off folks like these if we don't prepare the way first, breaking down barriers and leaving minds and souls free to encounter the truth. I'll give you evidence and arguments and step-by-step strategies based on asking the right questions to help them overcome their obstacles and make a straight path for the Lord. Order your copy of Prepare the Way today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Carlo Bussard is our guest this hour. And why does it matter to be a Catholic? I suppose we could give there might be personal reasons. My parents were, and I'm attached to my parish and all that. But there are broad reasons having to do with truth and human flourishing.
Sure.
Or why everyone should be Catholic.
Yeah, and it has to do with what Jesus revealed to us from the Father and what is Jesus's will. So, I mean, given the starting point of our love for Christ, our love for Jesus, that we want to submit to his will, well, then if he willed that the Catholic Church is indeed the church that he established, which he speaks of in Matthew 16, 18 through 19, which he promised to build on Peter, then it would matter to be Catholic precisely because we love Jesus. Now, that's not to say those who are not Catholic, visibly speaking, don't love Jesus. We're not saying that. For whatever reason why they're not Catholic, that's something we're going to have to talk about, right? I mean, they love Jesus, but the point being is that if we can affirm that antecedent, that if Jesus started the Catholic Church, well, then it would matter. And most people out there who love Christ, right, who try to follow Christ in their lives would acknowledge that. They just don't affirm the antecedent of that hypothetical condition, right?
Yes.
They'll say, no, Jesus didn't start the Catholic Church. Or, you know, maybe the Catholic Church was started by Christ, but then it became corrupt, and so you had this revamping of the purity of the gospel with Protestantism, etc. And then we'd have to call into question, well, what about Jesus's promises, right, about the Holy Spirit and about Satan not prevailing against his church, etc.?
And the fact that you can't find a single day since the resurrection of Jesus where there hasn't been a saint in the church somewhere. I mean, the witness of the saints throughout history is that the church has persevered, and those who wanted to found the true gospel there. Let's go to Robert in Topeka, Kansas. Okay. You are up first with Carla Broussard. Robert, your question.
Hi. Thank you very much for having me on. Okay. I'm a revert Catholic, reconciled February 2002 from 26 years away from the church.
Welcome back, brother.
I've been... Thank you. But the question is I'm doing a very small Catholic apologetics organization here.
Okay.
And the Northeast Kansas Catholic Apologist, and we're right now it's like pretty much me and a mailbox, and I'm getting started on that. But one of my primary question is I've run into some people who are really big into the old 16th century Fox's Book of Martyrs.
Right.
And I know that it has a mixture of truth and a lot of falsity.
Right.
I'm just wondering, what is the best charitable approach to, you know, say, hey, this is not good material to use against the church?
Yeah, you know, Robert, that's a great question, brother, and you've just inspired me of something new I can listen to on my drive now. Cy and I were talking about this prior to the show on what to listen to as we're commuting, as commuters. But unfortunately, Robert, I have yet in my journey of knowledge and in my formation and study to read Fox's Book of Martyrs and to really look into this issue in depth. So I can't comment on the book itself and the claims that it makes. I am aware, and I have come across, as you mentioned, Robert, that there is a mixture of historical truth and manipulation of that historical truth and exaggeration, etc. So here's a couple of thoughts I do have to share, even though I haven't looked into the book itself. Let's just say, for argument's sake, that what the book portrays in the history of the Catholic Church is true, and that the Catholic Church did, you know, persecute all of these Protestants that it says the Catholic Church persecuted. And did the Catholic Church unjustly persecute individuals who were opposing the faith, the Catholic faith? Yes. Did it do it as much as Fox's Book of Martyrs portrays it? It has. That's something I'll have to look into. I know the conclusion is no, but in order to justify that claim, I'd have to do the research myself. But just for argument's sake, Robert, it matters in the sense that it causes scandal. And for the Church of Christ to unjustly relate to people who oppose what she teaches, right? That causes great scandal throughout the world. And that is something that our Blessed Lord is not happy with, right? That goes contrary to his will to relate to people who oppose her in an unjust manner, all right? Let's just say, for argument's sake, it is unjust. That in no way takes away from the truth that the Catholic Church is indeed established by Christ, and all of those aspects of the Catholic Church that are of divine origin are promised to be protected by the Holy Spirit, and that the human dimension of the church will not be able to corrupt. So, Robert, I would take this approach of trying to explain to these people that, listen, there are two dimensions of the church that Christ established. There's a divine dimension and a human dimension, just like the hypostatic union in Christ, a divine nature and a human nature, right? And the divine dimension refers to that the Catholic Church was established by Christ, that Jesus Christ established the church with a hierarchical structure of ministers, right? Bishops and priests who govern and communicate to us truth and life through the sacraments. These are divine aspects of the church that Jesus promised nobody's going to be able to screw it up, right? We may cause scandal with our human failures and lead people away from these great gifts of truth and life, but the truth and the life itself, Robert, will not be corrupted by our faults, our human faults. So if we can establish that divine dimension And then that sets a context for understanding the human dimension, where guess what? Those bishops and priests, those leaders that Jesus invests authority with to guide and lead his people here on earth, in human matters, where it comes, where it goes beyond the boundaries of divine revelation of faith and morals, they're subject to messing up. They can sin, and they can greatly sin. And the way the church relates to people in the world can be unjust and at fault. But that does not take away from the ministry itself that Jesus invested to the church to govern the people of God, to teach the people of God, and to sanctify the people of God. What do you think of that, Robert?
I think that is an excellent answer. It's like infallibility in definitively teaching faith and moral is unaffected by the personal sins of our members.
Yes, you hit the nail on the head, Robert. Now watch this. Here's another line of approach that you can take, another strategy, if you will. Think about the logic embedded in that argument. Well, look at what the church, all of these bad things the leaders of the church did. Therefore, we can't belong to the Catholic Church. Okay, let's take that logic, Robert. Now, let's apply that to the apostles in the first century. Look at what all those first century Christian leaders did. They sinned. They let Jesus be taken to the cross, and they killed Jesus. They were cowards. They left him. They hid in a room. That's some pretty bad sinning going on. Should we not be a Christian? Of course not. So just because those who possess the leadership roles fell in their humanity, right? Fell in living up to the Christian standard, it doesn't follow from that they don't have the authority to teach the Christian standard.
Robert, thanks so much for that lively engagement and for your thoughtful questions. Appreciate
Amen.
It so much. We go now to Dan in Cincinnati listening on Ave Maria Radio. Dan, thanks for your call. You're on with Carlo. Your question, please.
Hi, gentlemen. Thanks for taking my call. I think, and I'm paraphrasing a little bit here, I think I heard you say a moment ago that salvation outside the church is possible for practicing Protestant Christians who are, I think you said, who are not culpably ignorant of the Catholic faith, of the Catholic option. And right. My concern and my question is that in the United States today, in the Catholic Church, obviously being so well known, and we enjoying in the United States as we do freedom of religious practice and,
sure.
and expression, can we expect that there are many, if any, practicing Protestant Christians who are innocently ignorant of the Catholic option in a way that we could, that we can have much confidence is going to afford salvation to many people
yep.
who are, as I said, practicing Protestant Christians.
Yeah. Yeah. They shouldn't. Is it fair to say, oh, well, look, everybody in America knows what it is to be a Catholic. They can't really be ignorant of it.
Right.
Therefore, they can't be saved.
Yeah. I would respond to that and say, no, it's not fair to say that.
Oh, yeah.
And now, Dan, I totally get where you're coming from, brother. It's a great question. But let me ask you this. I'm interested to know, have you ever encountered a Protestant who said to you that we worship Mary? Has that ever happened to you?
Sure.
Okay. Well, don't you think that given the access to the teachings of the Catholic Church that Protestant has in 21st century America, right? Don't you think that they should have known by now that we don't worship Mary? Does that make sense?
Certainly, and I know a great many Protestants
right.
who don't or are not mistaken about Catholic belief.
Got it. But I totally get that. But that individual person, right, who was mistaken, well, that tells me that at least it's possible, right? Even given the accessibility to Catholic teaching for Protestants out there, that they could very well still be invincibly ignorant about what the church teaches. So let's just use that individual for example. That person who told you, yeah, why do y'all Catholics worship Mary, right? Well, that person is making a judgment in his or her mind that, you know, no, I'm not going to belong to the Catholic Church because they worship Mary. But notice that their judgment to reject the Catholic Church is not actually a positive act of the will in rejecting the truth of the Catholic Church. They're rejecting what they think the Catholic Church teaches. But that's not what the Catholic Church teaches. So in essence, that individual is not rejecting the church. And if, Dan, that individual is not responsible for his or her ignorance or that false conclusion and false judgment about what the church teaches, well, then it's possible that whatever grace that person is living by, it's possible for that person to be saved. So my point being that I don't think it's fair to say that, to make the blanket statement and say, given the great accessibility, you know, in our modern age to the Catholic Church's teaching, that nobody can possibly be excused when it comes to knowledge of what the church teaches. But I think that there are cases where individuals are invincibly ignorant. People who really love Jesus and who just have never maybe had the time to do a robust inquiry into what the church teaches, and so they're simply relying on what they've been taught from their pastors, etc. So I think we have to keep that in mind and at least hold out the possibility.
Okay, Dan?
And if I may, just
go ahead.
I think I see where you're going, and my concern is that now there are a great many people who have just been, they were just raised Protestant, they believe a certain thing, and they've always believed either in the beginning or sort of continuing on through adult life that the Catholics had something wrong or were adding too much. I think the thought is that we've overlaid a simple and beautiful simple Christian faith with more than is necessary, and I think a lot of Protestants shy away from that. But it isn't some kind of a deeply mistaken understanding of Catholic faith. It's sort of like
a predisposition kind of against it. Well, Dan, I'll let you finish that thought,
yeah.
And we'll come back to that right after this. We have to take a quick break. Why does it matter to be Catholic is our question of the hour this hour. Here to answer that question, Carlo Bussard, apologist, author, and speaker extraordinaire. Right back after this.
This is Archbishop J. Michael Miller of Vancouver, Canada, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
Well, I don't think we're like the typical college students because we really hang out at our campus ministry and everything. It's amazing about how much more connected you feel. We share really cool articles from actually you guys, EWTN, and like what you were saying about evangelization. So that's really nice.
EWTN, live truth, live Catholic.
This is Tim Staples, and I'm really excited to tell you about a special limited-time offer we've got right now on subscriptions to our award-winning Catholic Answers magazine. Sign up today during our annual subscription drive, and not only can you save big bucks off the normal price, we'll give you a digital subscription to the magazine for free. Subscribe today by calling 818-487-2011 or logging online to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com. Sign up for a one-year subscription and we'll give you $10 off the normal price. Better yet, become a two-year subscriber and we'll up the ante by dropping the price $20. That's a saving of $10 to $20 plus a free digital subscription when you sign up for a subscription to Catholic Answers Magazine. Act now. This is our best offer of the year, and it's only available for a limited time. Subscribe to Catholic Answers Magazine before our annual subscription drive ends. Phone 818-487-2011 or go to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com today.
Why does it matter to be Catholic? That's the question of the hour. Why does it matter to be Catholic? I think that Carlo Bussard is our guest. Carlo is an apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church. And it's almost a root assumption of an apostolate like ours that it does matter, because that's what apologetics is, basically. Right. It's convincing people that it matters.
Right, 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 right. Convincing people of the truth of the Catholic faith. You
right.
know?
So we're talking with Dan in Cincinnati a bit. Dan, I had to interrupt you there just as we went to the break. Can you just real quick sum up that last question for Carlo? Dan?
Who are raised Protestant, just have some idea that we Catholics have added unnecessary layers of complication to the simple core Christian faith, which is really all that is necessary. And they just sort of had this disposition again that you mentioned that they were raised with, to believe that you know, I'm an evangelical Protestant, this is what I believe, and that's enough, and I'm overcomplicating things or overlaying things with rules and as I said, complications by becoming Catholic. So I'm not going to do that because this is kind of how I was raised, and this is where I am. And my concern for those people is that, well, it's certainly available to research and read and understand the fuller truth. And believe me, I would love to say, well, look, that person's in a good place. I'm personally invested here in the answer being that, hey, that person is not in danger, and my fear is that they are. Just to let you know where I'm coming from here. I'm not wishing to say, hey, you know, too bad.
I got
for
it.
You.
Yeah, I got it, Dan. No, it's a legitimate question, brother. I totally get it. So with regard to that individual now that you're bringing up, just sort of this predisposition of being raised Protestant, Catholics overcomplicate things. But think about this, Dan, that in that person's mind, they're saying, I'm not going to become Catholic. Why? Because they overcomplicate things. Well, why does that matter? Well, because they're working on the assumption that you need to have a pure gospel and not do all this stuff. So any sort of overcomplication of things about what Jesus taught and the Christian religion, well, that's bad. Therefore, I'm going to reject that which is bad. So in their intellectual inquiry, in their intellectual judgment, the premises on which they're basing their conclusion, I'm going to reject the church, objectively speaking, is good principles. I mean, you want to avoid some religion that's going to violate and overcomplicate things that Jesus came to give us if it is just simple stuff, right? So, but obviously I would challenge those premises and say, no, the Catholic Church is not overcomplicating things, because what the Catholic Church teaches is what Jesus taught, right? And what Jesus handed over to us and willed for us to be engaged in, and given the church certain authority for doctrine and discipline, etc., and the whole family idea, right? So we'd have to go through all of that. But the point being, Dan, is that in the intellectual reasoning that the person is going through, I can see how they would be following that which they would be avoiding that which they perceive to be bad, right? Following their conscience is what we would call that. Now, here's the key, Dan. Why are they mistaken in their intellectual judgments? Why are they mistaken in the premises on which they're basing their conclusion? I'm going to avoid the Catholic Church. That's a question that only God can answer, right? And we have to keep that in mind, Dan, that although we can say, you know, it's possible to be invincibly ignorant, we don't know who is invincibly ignorant. It's true to say someone who is invincibly ignorant is going to lose God's grace in their soul, right? Mortal sin. But we don't know who is invincibly ignorant. So I think we have to keep these principles in mind and not let the possibility of somebody outside the visible boundaries of the church being saved stop us from evangelizing that person. You see, Dan, I think that's the key, right? I mean, that's where you and I can agree 100%, and I know you're with me on this, brother, that even though it is possible, we still want to share with them the truth of the faith, because it is a great good that God has revealed to us, and God wills for that person to experience that good and experience the happiness that comes from experiencing that good. Does that make sense?
It does. Thank you, and thank you for easing my fears, but I'll keep working on this person who's very dear to me.
Okay, so. Dan. God bless you, brother.
God bless you, Dan. Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you, gentlemen. Yep, bye.
Oh, next call comes from Nigeria. Nono in Nigeria. Thank you so much for your call. You're on with Carlo. Your question, please, Nono.
Hi, Sai. Hey, Carlo.
Hi.
Before I ask my question, Sai, earlier today I was watching Patrick Coffin's last show, and a lot of people were saying he's left some really big shoes on whoever the new host would be. had a lot to fill in. And if I do say so myself, we enjoy having you here. You've way more than filled in those shoes.
You're very nice, Nono. As a matter of fact, Carlo, you can leave. Nono and I are just going to talk for the rest of the show. That's a very kind thing to say. Thank you very, very much. Because Patrick is extraordinary.
I agree with you, Nono, 100%. Sai is doing a fantastic job.
Thank you.
Can we get any other callers on this topic? Sorry, Nono. Go ahead. Your question.
So, Carlo, I'm Catholic myself. I enjoy being Catholic. I have a lot of good reasons why it's important to be Catholic. And what's happening is three of my closest friends are, one of them's Muslim, the other is Jewish, and the other is Hindu. So these guys have these, their religious identities, which are kind of like social identities. You know, it's not like the way we have personal relationships with God and stuff like that. It's kind of like who they are, if you understand what I'm saying.
I got you. Yep.
So I've been friends with these people, each at for varying amounts of time. And in a small way, the way I live out my faith and the way I'm joyful about it, I've been told by them, you know, it's very inspiring. And I often get comments like, oh, if I wasn't any other religion, or if I was thinking of converting, I'd definitely be Catholic. But like, the thing is, it's not important enough for them to want to. Like, they don't see why they should become Catholic. It's because, you know, the way they've been living out their own religions aren't the same way. And, you know, I felt with all the work you do on explaining relativism and all of that, you'd be an amazing person to ask for how to best minister to these people without, you know, coming out and Bible bashing or missing their own cultures and stuff like that.
Yeah, so, no, I think, with these particular friends that you just mentioned, obviously starting with, you know, the Eucharist or confession or the Pope or something is not going to work, right? Because we got to get these individuals back to square two, I might say. Well, actually square three, because square one is truth, square two is God, square three is Jesus, right? So we got to get them to Jesus. And I would recommend to you to begin studying and equipping yourself to talk about Jesus with non-Christians, to talk about Jesus not only in the personal way, which you already know how, and I can hear that in your voice, Nono, but to talk about Jesus in a way that refers to him as a real historical person, and that we have access to what this real historical person said and what he did. And this dude rose from the dead, right? And all in that resurrection from the dead is within this context of this man, Jesus, making all of these claims about being equal to Almighty God, which means he's the very reason why we exist, about being the very source of our happiness, our complete and definitive human happiness, promising a relationship of perfect knowledge and love in the afterlife, right? With all of those who believe in him, and on and on. And all of those claims being vindicated by his resurrection from the dead. Because no, if Jesus rose from the dead, then Christianity is true. And if Christianity is true, then any person of goodwill who has this impetus to inquire about truth is going to be moved to embrace that truth. So I would recommend my book, Prepare the Way. I have a section in there, no, called Prepare the Way for Jesus. And I give you strategies. I coach you in strategies on how to remove certain obstacles that people may have when it comes to the Jesus question. I would also recommend a nice book out there called The Jesus Shock. I think it's by Dr. Peter Kraft. And it's sort of a popular read, but it's a great read, which teaches you how to sort of let people encounter Jesus in a real way for the first time, like the Jesus Shock. He's not just some, you know, a lovey-dovey, fuzzy-wuzzy dude in the sky or something, but like the real Jesus of history, who made certain claims on our lives and who rose from the dead, right? And I think, no, perhaps if you begin sharing your faith in that way with your friends, at least is going to properly dispose them, get them thinking about, you know what, this is just not pie-in-the-sky stuff. This is a real deal, real history, a real guy who really rose from the dead and making claims on my life. And so I need to start asking certain questions. Am I going to accept these claims? Am I going to accept his invitation to follow him? I know Noah has given me good reasons to do so. It makes sense. And so let me look into this a little bit more. And thus they're on the journey of the inquiry. And then that's where you come in to guide them on that journey. And once they come to accept Christ, then lead them into the fullness of Jesus' truth with the Catholic Church. So I think, no, you need to roll up your sleeves and start doing your homework and digging in, sister, so that you can start talking about Jesus to your friends, not only from the personal experience, but on the intellectual side and the historical experience of Christ.
No, how does that all sit with you?
That's awesome. Thank you. It's funny that your recommendation, because about a week ago, I was arguing with my Muslim friend's younger brother that Jesus was a real person, and I could not understand how he couldn't see that.
That's right.
And I'm changing my major after a few years of studying engineering. I'm moving to religion and theology. So this is perfect timing. Thank you so much.
Well, hey, if you'll give your address to Thomas, our call screener, I'll send you a free copy of Carlo's book, Prepare the Way. That'll at least get you started. And would that be okay with you?
Yeah. Does it have to be an American address, or do you ship internationally?
Oh, no. This is fun for the shipping department. I want to give them a Nigeria address to have to send it to. So,
if
it doesn't get to you, if you call back, though, and let us know. And I like to give away Carlo's book because it's just a great book. And if I give it away, Carlo doesn't get paid. So that's two really good things. Thanks, Nono, for your call. You look so mad, Carlo. Oh, you look so mad when I said you don't get paid.
Hey, brother.
I got
five kids to feed, man, plus my wife, man. Also, I have my best friend and his six kids over at the house for a week.
Okay,
so I
I'll pay you for
too.
The book. I'll pay you for the book.
No, we're very happy to do that. I'm so glad no call.
I know.
You know, Si, this is fantastic, man, because notice her joy at least piqued their interest.
I know. Isn't that wonderful? And that's how it's supposed to work.
Amen. So right. God bless you, sister. And that's the first step, right? They're attracted. Yeah. And so now, you know, she has their respect. So if she starts sharing with them some of the historical evidence for Jesus, then at least they're in a good position to perhaps be open to that information.
Yeah.
And the fact that her friend was saying, well, I don't even believe Jesus exists. This is exactly what I point out in my book, right? How can you talk to somebody about what Jesus said and did and the fact that he rose from the dead if they don't first think he existed, right? So that's an obstacle to the truth of Jesus that no can help that remove in order for that person to embrace the truth of Jesus.
Somebody should write a whole book just on overcoming obstacles to God or to the gospel or to the church.
Hey, you know what? I think there's that Raging Cajun dude.
Oh, yeah. Carlo Bouchard, Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church at shop.catholic.com right now. But not for no, she's getting it free. We'll be right back after this with Catholic Answers Live.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers. I'm sure you have heard that it's still okay these days to hold to the quaint superstitions of Catholicism as long as you leave them in church, because when it comes to reality, religion is just foolishness that withers in the fierce light of science. Problem is, this narrative is false. It is in the Christian West that scientific discovery has most flourished. Still, too many of us find ourselves flat-footed when confronted with bugbears like Adam and Eve versus evolution, creation versus Big Bang, and Galileo versus the Inquisition. What can you do? Come to Catholic Answers' 5th National Conference, Faith and Science. Guest speakers Father Terry Ehrman and Dr. Stacy Trasankos will join the whole Catholic Answers team to explain how faith and science are actually in harmony. September 27 to 30, right here in San Diego. And we are thrilled to announce a special keynote address by Raymond Leo Cardinal Burke honoring the 50th anniversary of Humanae Vitae. For all the details, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Pope Francis said, all of us are called to mature in our work as evangelizers. We want to have better training, a deepening love, and a clear witness to the gospel. St. Paul Street Evangelization's online School of Evangelization will equip you with the tools you need to be an effective evangelist. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you're unable to give, we'll set you up for free. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Carla Broussard right here in the studio with us. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and we're talking about why does it matter to be Catholic? An important question to answer, whether you are not a religious person, maybe not a Catholic person, or if you are a Catholic person. Knowing the answer, why does it matter to be Catholic, is a really good thing. Next caller is Michael. I don't know where Michael is calling from, but Michael, you are on with Carla Broussard. Your question.
Yes, I'm calling from Albuquerque, and can you hear me?
Yep, Michael, we got you loud and clear.
Okay, all right. It's like, why should we be Catholic when half the Catholics aren't going to church?
Very good question, Michael, and the answer is because for the sake of the truth. Just because some people choose not to follow the truth and to embrace the truth, it doesn't follow from that that I shouldn't embrace the truth. I don't care, Michael, if every single person in the entire world chooses to walk away from the truth. You, Michael, me, Michael, I, Michael, am called to embrace that truth. So the operating principle in all of this stuff, Michael, is, does the Catholic Church have the fullness of the truth that Christ willed to give God's people on earth? If the answer to that question is yes, well then I don't care how many people don't think it's important. I don't care how many people walk away from it. I am called by God to embrace that truth and to be a member of that church that Christ established, because I am made for the truth, Michael, and I can only find my true, authentic human happiness in that truth. And so that is why I would say we should be Catholic. That's why it matters to be Catholic, even though, as you mentioned, Michael, half of Catholics aren't going to Mass anymore. In fact, there was a study done that fewer than 4 in 10 Catholics attend church in any given week in the U.S. So it is true to say that there is a decline, at least in the U.S.
Yeah.
Other places in the world, man, they're busting out at the seams, right? But at least in the U.S., there is a decline in church attendance.
Can I tell you something, too? Out of that 4 out of 10, not many are singing either. I mean, come on, people. We need to bring it. There's only 4 out
That's
of 10
right.
of us here.
Yeah.
Let's
so,
get singing.
So, Michael, I will agree with you that there is a crisis and a problem of Catholic Church attendance in the U.S., but, my friend, just as the apostles leaving Christ at the foot of the cross was not a good reason for John to leave Christ at the foot of the cross, so too, just because some Catholics are leaving or not going to the foot of the cross at the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, it's not a good reason for us not to be there.
I'm here in Rio Rancho, and we have a really hot church. So,
beautiful.
St. Thomas Aquinas. So,
St. Thomas Aquinas, anyway, the patron of apologists.
That's right. Well, Michael, blessed be God for that, brother, and continue to bring that joy and to bring that vibrancy in your parish, man. And hopefully that joy and vibrancy can overflow into other parishes and increase church attendance elsewhere.
Thanks, Michael. Thanks very much for that call. John now in Monterey, California, who's listening on the Catholic Answers app. Hey, John, thanks for putting the app on your phone. Anybody can do it for free. We appreciate that you did. And your question for Carlo.
Hey, guys. Carlo, I'm a big fan, man. Just want to put that out there, big fan.
Thanks, brother. You're too kind.
My question is, so I have a little brother who was Catholic, was baptized and everything, and now he's looking for God, which is great for us and our family. But he's really into this video called Why I Love Jesus But I Hate Religion. I think that's what it's called.
Oh, yeah.
And he's really, Yeah, yeah. So he's really, and I got hooked on it too years ago. I got hooked on it. I thought it was the most truthful thing I saw until I started listening to you guys. Until I started going to Catholic Church and it kind of opened my eyes about this video.
Yeah.
So now he bought the book, and then I kind of confronted him about it. Like, why are you even reading this? So why don't you just go to Mass? And then he's like, well, to be honest with you, I'm trying to better my relationship with God. I was like, well, and this is the answer? And he's like, well, I think so. Right. So how do I defend that? I guess what I'm trying to say is, how do I pull him back?
Right. Well, John, I wish I could remember. There is a priest out there, and I'm sure somebody online knows the priest's name.
Was it Mike Schmitz?
No, it wasn't Mike Schmitz. It may have been, but it's not him, the one I'm thinking of, but there was a priest out there who did a video, a fantastic video. Is it Father Pontifex?
I'll look it up if you want. Okay.
And he actually did a video to respond to that video, John, and this priest did a fabulous job on it. So if you can somehow find that video, unfortunately, I can't think of it.
Father Pontifex, Father Pontifex. I love religion and love Jesus.
There you go, Father Pontifex, John, so look that up. That's at least a starting point, but I think more fundamentally, John, what has to happen is I think you said it was your brother. Notice what he said is that, well, I'm not going to go to Mass because I'm trying to increase my relationship with Jesus. As if the Mass is not a way by which you can increase your relationship with Jesus, right? So we're going to have to address that premise, that assumption, John. And the way that you do that, brother, is you start reading about the Mass. I have an audio CD set, the Bible Blueprint for the Mass. You can check out Edward Sree from Ascension Press, a biblical walk through the Mass, I think is what it's called. We have several articles online at Catholic.com, John, that you can read about the Mass. I have some as well from Catholic Answers Magazine online, going through the Mass as the heavenly liturgy. Check out the Lamb's Supper, Dr. Scott Hahn. So what has to happen, John, is you got to get some resources, brother, from Catholic sources that talk about the Mass, the biblical roots of the Mass, the theology of the Mass, and that Jesus Christ is literally present in the Holy Eucharist, man. And whenever you get that stuff, you learn it and you can explain it to your brother along with sharing the materials and say, hey, look, bro, if you want to increase your relationship with Jesus, well, then once you understand what the Mass is, well, then this is the way to go. Yeah, sure, you can pray to Jesus in the privacy of your own home, private scripture reading. Those are all good. Those are all great. But guess what? There's something better. It's Jesus Christ himself present in the Holy Eucharist, right? And all the graces that flow from the font of the Mass. That is the highest way, the best way, by which we can become closer and united to Jesus Christ. So once you get all that stuff, John, you can share that with your brother. Walk with him. Journey with him in that study and in that inquiry. And then hopefully you'll be in a better position to say, yeah, I want to be closer to Jesus. The Mass gets me closer to Jesus, so I'm going to go to Mass. Does that make sense?
That makes great sense. Thank you so much, Carlo. I really appreciate it. I just want to tell you guys, so my name is John Isidro. Could you guys just please pray for me, please?
Indeed, we will, brother.
Okay, we will, John. Thank you. Thanks so much for the call, John. Also, Nancy Joe on Facebook says Bishop Barron also did a response to the
Why
I Hate Religion thing. So you can find them both on there. And thanks, Nancy Joe, for letting us know that. Let's see if we can real quick get one or two more questions in here before we have to go. Carlos in El Paso watching on YouTube. Thanks for watching on YouTube, Carlos. Your question for Carlo.
Hi, hello, you guys. You guys, I think, are doing a great job there with your whole ministry there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carlos.
So I have a boss, and he's Christian Science.
Okay.
And, he's been my boss for several years, and it's at the point where there's almost nothing we can say to each other that can offend us. However, he makes fun of the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
He says that the Catholic Church was founded by Emperor Constantine.
Okay.
And he has a handful of statements, and he sounds very confident.
Sure.
As if that supposedly this Emperor Constantine did start the church with
Okay.
Well, let's let it's okay. I just the time is ticking away here, so I want Carlo to give an answer to that, because that's not an uncommon thing.
Correct. Okay, Carlos, here we go. An answer from Carlo, man. All right. I would simply respond to that, Carlos, and say, okay, boss, have you ever heard of a gentleman by the name of Ignatius of Antioch? And he'll probably say, no. And then you can say, well, it's interesting you say that the Catholic Church was started by Constantine in the 4th century, because this dude, Ignatius of Antioch, he wrote a letter to these Christians in Smyrna in AD 107, maybe 110 at latest. And he talks about wherever the Catholic Church is, there is Jesus Christ. He actually uses the Greek term Catholicos in reference to the Christian community as the Catholic Church, and in passing, and gives no explanation as if it's always been used. Then I would ask him, have you ever heard of Irenaeus of Lyons? In AD 150, in his work Against Heresies, he gives a list of successors to St. Peter in the bishopric of Rome, from Peter to the present-day Bishop of Rome, Eleutherus, which is historical evidence that the Catholic Church was alive and well way before Constantine.
Carlos, I'll just let you know, if you want more on that, go to Catholic.com and just type in Constantine founded the church. You'll find all kinds of materials there to help you work through that. So Carlo Broussard, thanks so much.
Hey, thank you, Si. It was a joy, my friend.
If you want Carlo to come speak to your group, go to CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com. If you want his book, go to shop.catholic.com. The book is Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the Gospel, and the Church. Next hour, Lisa Cooper's coming in. She's going to be on the line with us. And Lisa was raised in Prosperity Gospel, Catholic now. You're going to love this.
This is Dale Alquist of the American Chesterton Society, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed the list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carlo Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Christian men, beware. With the idols of materialism, entertainment, and the flesh, it's plain to see that the world wants you for its own. Face it, it's tempting and easy to be a man of the world. Father Terence Ehrman has a challenge for you. Be a man of God instead. In his new book, Man of God, Lessons to Young Men About Life, Sex, Friendship, Vocation, and Loving with the Heart of Christ, Father Ehrman draws on his experiences counseling men who are struggling to live in the world, but not be of the world. In a unique format, he offers a plan for ongoing conversion, holy spiritual direction for all men who want to master themselves and be transformed from within. Order your copy of Man of God today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Behold Your Mother, a biblical and historical defense of the Marian doctrines by apologist and speaker Tim Staples is an apologetics tour de force, which delves deeper than ever before into the Catholic Church's teaching on our Blessed Mother, from her Immaculate Conception to the Annunciation, from her title as Mother of God to her perpetual virginity, from her Assumption into Heaven to her role as co-redemptrix. Tim gives you the facts and backs them up with solid biblical evidence in the way only Tim Staples can do. Call 1-888-291-8000, log on to Catholic.com, or visit a good Catholic bookstore in your area and get your copy of Behold Your Mother today. Now available in paperback and as an ebook. Get your copy today.
Did you know that there's a place you can turn first that features the newest, most exciting Catholic resources, as well as a huge selection by some of the best Catholic authors and speakers on the planet? It's our online store at shop.catholic.com. All of our offerings are time-tested and apologist-vetted and trustworthy and faithful to the teachings of the Catholic Church. And, of course, the lights are always on for your shopping convenience. It's one-stop shopping made affordable and easy. shop.catholic.com.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll-free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. This hour we welcome a guest I've really been looking forward to having on, and we cover a topic of utmost importance to importance to anyone who believes in the gospel of Jesus Christ, a gospel of the cross, of compassion for the poor, surrender not to our desires but to the love of God. This is a gospel in its elements that we share with our Christian brothers and sisters around the world, almost all of them, but we share it in a less clear obvious manifestation with what's called the prosperity gospel. And to be frank, in many ways, this gospel, the prosperity gospel, is not a true gospel. It does not reflect the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in all likelihood, today, at this very moment, there are members of your clan, your family, your circle, who have come to believe in this prosperity gospel to one degree or another. And it's a relatively magical properties, I suppose you would say. If you have questions about the prosperity gospel, if you would like help leading others to the true gospel of Jesus and away from the prosperity gospel, give us a call this hour, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Our guest was raised in the Word of Faith movement, which is the more precise term for the prosperity gospel movement, and knows both its habits and its history. Lisa Cooper is a convert to the Catholic faith, a mother of four, a speaker, a writer, an entrepreneur, and I could not be more thrilled to have her here. Lisa Cooper, thank you for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
So maybe we should just start with the basics. For those who might go, well, I don't know what they mean when they say prosperity gospel. It's all around us. They see it all around us. But what is the prosperity gospel?
So I'm losing my...
Not your mind, your headphones.
Well, there's that too.
Okay.
So, so the prosperity gospel is really, I mean, I think what most people perceive it to be is this, just this set of talking heads on TV of people who want your money and promise miracles in return. And while that is an aspect of prosperity gospel for sure, really the prosperity gospel, as we talked about before, is more accurately called the Word of Faith movement. And Word of Faith comes from this idea that because of the sacrifice that Jesus bought and paid for, that made, the sacrifice that Jesus made, he bought a certain authority for us on the earth. And we exercise that authority by using the words of our mouth to make confessions. In other words, we speak words of faith. And by using those words of faith, we can transform the physical world using spiritual principles. That's really where that comes from. And so prosperity is actually a byproduct of our using our faith, using our words in order to create a new reality for ourselves.
And an immediate danger suggests itself from that. Well, for one, it does not resemble much of what Jesus himself had to say or how he lived. But it seems to me that if you believe that if my faith is strong enough and I put my word of faith out there, it can transform reality. Mm-hmm. If your reality does not change in a favorable way, how do you have anyone to blame but yourself?
That's exactly it. And in fact, you're taught that exactly. I mean, these ministers will stand in the pulpit and say to you, if your child died, even though you were standing on your faith and making your confessions and doing everything that we told you to do, it's your fault. It's a failure of your faith. If your bills don't get paid, if that job doesn't manifest the way that you wanted it to. And in fact, these men will even apply this to their own lives. For example, Rodney Howard Brown, who is, he's Word of Faith, and he refers to himself as the Holy Ghost bartender, which may be a topic for another day. But sadly, he lost a daughter. And when he talks about the fact that his daughter died, and the funeral was attended by all of the, you know, the big guys in Word of Faith, and everyone was gathered around. And in fact, they waited until the last minute possible to put her coffin in the ground because they really were believing that she was going to be raised from the dead. And when they had to bury her, the thing that Rodney Howard Brown came out and said was, well, I lost that battle with the devil. I mean, he saw that as, I missed it. I failed. My faith didn't work. And so, you know, in a way, I think sometimes we point a finger at these guys and we're angry with them because we feel like they're very shaming to us. And it is it's a very shameful thing, I think, to feel like I'm doing my best and yet I still fall short in my faith. I still don't have these things being manifested in my life the way that I had hoped. But I will say that they do tend to turn that on themselves as well, that when they feel like something isn't happening in their life the way that it should, they sort of take their own medicine in that regard.
Which suggests a kind of sincerity of faith that is actually, when we dismiss some of these ministers as hucksters, they're doing mm-hmm. this just because they want money. They do want money, but they truly believe yeah. that when the money comes to them, that is a manifestation of their faith.
Mm-hmm. It is. It's a mixture of a great deception, and it's also a mixture of, you know, that great deception mixed with what happens to us just as human beings. You know, if I can tell this little short story on myself when it comes to a lack of humility, because I think that's the thing that we accuse them of. I know just recently, all over the internet, we saw this story that Jesse Duplantis was asking for $54 million for a plane that he is convinced that he needs in order to spread the gospel. You know, Creflo Dollar has a $65 million plane. Kenneth Copeland has over five planes. I mean, he has five different planes that belong to him. One of them is an old naval fighter plane. So, I mean, it's not like he needs that to go spread the gospel. So I think what happens is we sit here and we criticize them, and I think rightfully so, for wanting these extravagant things, but they didn't start off that way. Most of these guys started off in abject poverty or not far above it. And so they didn't go from the guy who drove some jalopy down the road to driving a Rolls Royce and having a $54 million plane. Incrementally, they got to that place because they believe they used their faith. And they don't see the correlation that if I stand in front of you and I say, hey, Cy, the Lord told me that if you will bless me, he will bless you. They don't see, well, of course you're blessed, because if I give you my money,
right,
then it's up to God to settle up with me. And I think, you know, I had this, trying to cultivate humility was something that was very important to me when I came into the Catholic Church. And I'm very drawn, of course, to St. Ignatius of Loyola. And of course, St. Francis of Assisi, their humility is just, it's awe-inspiring. And so I was praying and asking the Lord to help me cultivate humility. And I said, you know, Lord, it's very easy to be humble when you have no other choice. So give me a chance. You know, give me something and give me a chance to demonstrate that I can cultivate humility in my life. So I was on a flight from Austin to Shreveport, and I got bumped into first class. And I'm sitting in first class, and I'm talking to all these incredible people, and then they pull out the snacks of first class. And I wanted to stand up and like shout back to everybody else and go, you need to sit down with your tired peanuts, because do you know that we have chocolate covered popcorn up here with cranberries? And I was so, and in that moment, truly, yeah. I'm embarrassed to say this, I justified the idea of why I would need to be in first class. Like, this is such a cool thing. And you know, you would never get bumped from a flight. And that's so important when you travel. And suddenly I start justifying why it would be important for me to fly first class.
Right.
And it's like, I realized when I got home and I kind of was laughing in my prayer time with the Lord in my, you know, quest for humility. And I said, Lord, how am I ever going to be St. Ignatius when the snacks in first class are so great? And that's really what's happening with these guys. I mean, it yeah. happens in Crimea. Remember, like, Kenneth Copeland's been in ministry for 40 or 50 years. So you're talking about 50 years of incremental blessing that he believes he deserves.
Yeah.
And so then you finally do get to this place where you think you deserve a $54 million plane or a fleet of planes or any of these things.
But now you, on the other hand, experienced it as a child. And so
I did.
What is said to a child who, because, you know, kids' life is hard. You get your bumps and bruises. You don't know how to do stuff. You got to go through all these hardships to learn just how to do the basics of taking care of yourself. So when you are going through the miseries of childhood, which is part of the deal, what is the message to you about those miseries?
Well, when you're a child and you're sad over, I think you're not, at least I guess I wasn't introspective enough to understand the reasons why I was sad. I didn't understand, you know, these things are happening to me and that's what's making me sad. But I think as I got older, you know, and like I said, I had little childlike things that I prayed for that didn't come to pass. And I think I developed early on, not so much a resentment, maybe a little bit of a resentment of God, but more of a sense that he didn't love me. God doesn't do this for me because he doesn't love me. And because as a child, you don't really understand using your faith. You don't really know how to put that into action.
Right.
I mean, you do. You understand it's important that I say these things. I mean, growing up in my house, we were not allowed to say, I'm sick. I had to say, I believe that the devil is trying to give me a cold, and I believe I'm healed in Jesus' name. But I wasn't allowed to go to my mom and say, I'm sick. We weren't allowed to say, you scared me. And I had two brothers who would love to jump out and scare me. And we were not allowed to say, you know, shout at my brother and go, you scared me. My mom said, no, you can't ever confess fear, because fear is the opposite of faith. And so I think growing up in Word of Faith, it was more understanding the rules than it was necessarily pondering why they didn't always work. But it wasn't until I got to be an adult that I understood, and really I think that burden of shame of not being enough, of not being good enough, that's when that really started to sink in for me and build that resentment.
Because the material things of this world are the evidence of your faith in the Word of
Faith
movement. And so if things are not working out for you, it's clearly because it's manifest to everyone in the community. Mm-hmm. You don't have enough faith to be doing better.
Right. That's exactly right. And they equate that with the blessing of Abraham. They say, well, Abraham was greatly blessed, and that was the mark of God on his life. And now we are in this covenant that Jesus formed for us on our behalf, and we are to walk in that same kind of blessing. And so it's kind of a very Jewish perspective, that the more blessed you are, the more favor you must have with God. And so it is this concept of not only your faith, but also your favor. They teach that all the time, that I'm one of God's There's a man named Jerry Savelle who teaches a whole series on being one of God's favorites, like the Malachites, but I'm a favorite. And all of these things that God does for me. And of course, he talks about jet setting all over the world with different famous people. And I mean, literally, there was a move, I want to say in the mid-90s, in Word of Faith, where churches all over the world, if you were the person standing up preaching, people would run from their seats and drop money at your feet. And so then these preachers would talk about, God must love me, I'm one of his favorites, because I left truly with a garbage bag full of tens of thousands of dollars.
Yeah, right.
And so when you're sitting there, you think, well, God must not love me at all, because all I'm leaving here with is unpaid bills.
Right. So we have to take a quick break, Lisa. And I think I'd like to you to explain to us when we come back a couple things. One, why this is important for Catholics to know. In the world today, why should Catholics know about this prosperity gospel and what it's doing to people? But also, I want to talk about the secular parallels, because we see people putting things out into the universe and doing these other secular things that actually do have a historical connection to the prosperity gospel movement. And you are the person to explain it. If you'd like to talk with Lisa Cooper about the prosperity gospel, the Word of Faith movement, 888-318-7884 is our number. We'll take that break. We'll be right back with your calls and Lisa Cooper right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
The 18th century skeptic philosopher David Hume argued the wise man should never believe in miracles because the evidence for what occurs over and over, the regular, always outweighs evidence for what does not, the rare. But is Hume right? Well, no, and here are some reasons why. First, it's not true evidence for uniform experience always outweighs evidence for what is rare. For example, have you experienced any Big Bangs lately? My guess is no. Does that mean we should reject the Big Bang? Of course not. Second, Hume's principle nullifies science itself. How could scientists ever reasonably use new findings to update their understanding of the universe if it's unreasonable to accept what contradicts our uniform experience? The answer is, they couldn't. So, are miracles in and of themselves off limits for the wise, as Hume puts it? Absolutely not. I'm Carlo Broussard with the Ready Reason for Catholic Answers, Catholic.com.
God helps those who help themselves. Preach the gospel always. When necessary, use words. We all hear sayings like these, and we assume they come from the Bible, the saints, or famous Christian writers. Nobody can seem to place their origin, but by sheer repetition, they've acquired a halo of truth. In my new book, What the Saints Never Said, I look at over 40 of these well-known sayings and track them back to their original sources. You'll be surprised at what I found. Some are close to what was really said. Many were misattributed or twisted beyond their original meaning, and more than a few of these sayings were simply made up. I hope by setting the record straight, I can make you aware of the theological errors that can lead us away from the faith and offer you authentic quotes from scripture, saints, and scholars that will draw you closer to our faith. Get your copy of What the Saints Never Said by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, great big Wednesday show. This hour we're talking with Lisa Cooper, who was raised in what is called internally into the movement, the Word of Faith movement. Many people know it as, maybe a word like, or a phrase such as name it and claim it, or prosperity gospel. We often make fun of it when people like Creflo Dollar, for example, say they need millions of dollars to buy a plane, and they call on their TV viewers and various disciples to give them money in order to do that. But it's not the caricature that we think it is. Lisa knows this because she was raised in the Word of Faith, later converted to Catholicism. Did you experience your conversion to Catholicism as a liberation?
Oh, gosh, yes. And in fact, I had some very unkind things prophesied over me by some of these Word of Faith pastors about my conversion experience, things, curses that would come on me if I continued in my Catholic faith. And initially I was very afraid because, you know, I had always grown up believing these are the men of God, and they have this, you know, connection to God that I don't have. And if they say something, then you should obey. But I knew in my heart that I was following the truth. And I believe just the graces of the Blessed Mother protected me. And once I was home and settled in the church and really began to let that truth sink in and the grace of the sacraments enlighten my life, then absolutely, I've been very free and have a relatively, well, probably annoyingly joyful disposition because of it. So,
Well, I'm glad to hear that. So thus far, it hasn't been annoying. I'll let you know if it becomes annoying, however. So let's get to that question about Catholics then. I mean, a Catholic listening on a Catholic radio station, we're talking about what appears to be primarily a Protestant movement. And certainly, we don't want to imply that all Protestant people accept this, name it and claim it, or give to get type theology. They don't. But so why do I as a Catholic have concern about this? Why should I worry about it?
Well, I think what we're seeing more and more in the Catholic world, a couple of things. One is we're seeing Catholics who, you know, sort of peek over the fence and see what's going on in Joel Osteen's camp or Joyce Meyer's or Joseph Prince. Those are kind of three of the big ones, especially Joel Osteen. And they think, you know, this guy, he's such a great guy. He's so kind. I always refer to him as being very sweet. And he is, I think, a very sweet, sweet man. And so not only do you hear this kindness and this very loving and very accepting message, but what you're also hearing is, you know what? You have the power to change your life by declaring things over your life. And so you have Catholics who are beginning to sort of, I don't want to say necessarily corrupt their own faith, but they're certainly introducing a corrupting influence into their faith. So you can be going to Mass, you can be receiving the sacraments, but it's a very subtle when you come in and you hear, you know what, I'm just gonna start finding some things that the Bible says about my life and confessing those things or declaring those things over my life. And there's nothing wrong with that. But you know, if you go in and let's just say you start reading 1 Peter 2:24, which talks about the fact that by his stripes we were healed, which is a reference to Isaiah 53. Well, that is true. We were healed by the stripes of Jesus. And Jesus does still, in his sovereignty, God does still choose to heal us sometimes. But that scripture doesn't mean that God's going to heal you physically every time. In fact, when you go back and read Isaiah 53, it talks about the fact that what God heals us from is our sin. He frees us from our sin. And then the other healing that we will experience will be that healing that we will have, that total and complete healing of any disease, of any ailment, and of course through purgatory, any remnant of sin that remains in us on our way to heaven and when we get to heaven. But people don't see it that way. And what's being taught by Joyce Meyer, by Joel Osteen, is kind of this heaven on earth mentality. And after a while, a couple of things can happen. One is you can become very resentful because your life isn't changing the way you want it to. And so you can start to question God's love for you or feel like he doesn't care about you or why isn't this working for me because all these other people are being healed and I'm not. Or you can begin to kind of grow cold toward the Catholic faith and say, well, God, over at this church, you know, I feel loved, I feel welcome, and the worship is so amazing. And, you know, and so people will leave Mass because they think the Mass is supposed to be about their feelings and their emotions and their experience with God. And they suddenly have this misunderstanding, maybe not suddenly, but they have this misunderstanding of what liturgy is for, and that Mass is for the sacraments, Mass is for the Eucharist. Mass is when we come in and we receive the body, blood, soul, and divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the sacrifice of the Mass. It's not the feel-good, jump up and down of the Mass. And so these teachers who, you know, Joel Osteen, Joyce Meyer, people like that, and Joyce Meyer's not she's not big on follow your feelings, but it's easy to follow our feelings when we're hearing people who talk about you can have a better life and it's all in your hands. You can control it all. And it's very subtle, but it does remove the sovereignty of God from our lives. And it does remove, the second thing I was going to say is that it also removes that command that we carry crosses when we're going to follow after the Lord.
Right. We resent any cross that comes our way instead of saying, Jesus said, take up your cross each day and follow me.
Well, what we're taught to do is we rebuke those crosses.
Oh.
We call them the devil and we tell them to get away and we start praying scriptures over them instead of understanding that these were designed to transform us into the image of God himself.
I think also there are many Catholics who have a kind of subtle connection to a very, very similar message, and I wonder if they're connected, that's more of a New Agey, The Secret, a little bit of Oprah Winfrey message, which is, if I put it out there in the universe, that's how I make it real. This sounds so similar to the prosperity gospel. I wonder if they are connected.
It actually is the exact same thing. It's just that people in Word of Faith justify what they are doing by saying, well, no, because we're not asking the universe, we're asking God. And this is all God-centered, this is God-designed. But what they really don't understand is that the history of their faith is rooted in the occult. It is rooted in Eastern religion. It is rooted in this idea that somehow we're all God. We're all little gods. Now, Word of Faith will say, you're not God, as in God with a big G, but you're a little God. And you're supposed to exercise the same kind of authority as that God did on the earth before the fall. You're supposed to exercise that authority in your life. And so all of that, and in fact, it's kind of funny because all of the concepts in The Secret, even though The Secret is kind of a new thing, all of those ideas and concepts are part of the New Thought movement, which predates the Word of Faith movement.
A late 19th century movement, mostly centered in Massachusetts and Boston.
Yes.
Probably connected to the Transcendentalist movement that came before it, but it's not Christian in its roots.
Right, exactly. Now, there were some people who were involved in New Thought who considered themselves Christian, and that was very prevalent in the Boston area, in the New England area, because it did come on the heels of Transcendentalism, where, of course, you have Emerson, you have Thoreau, and you have this sort of think tank of these great thinkers, philosophers of the age.
Well, you can hear. You can hear the music. That means we have to take a quick break. So these threads are there all throughout the culture. They are within the Catholic Church. They are on media constantly, and they are among those who are practicing Word of Faith as a particular strain of Protestantism. Certainly not mainstream Protestantism. And we'll talk with Lisa more about why this is not the true gospel of Jesus Christ, and that gospel is better. We'll be right back.
Every question is important. Ask yours today on Catholic Answers Live.
It might be said that anti-Catholic notions of the Church's history are the original fake news. With all the misinformation being spread, where does one look for the truth? In The Real Story of Catholic History, Professor Steve Weidenkopf gives you the facts on over 50 of the most common misconceptions about Catholic history and shows how to answer them simply and powerfully. Whether it's to answer claims about Catholicism's supposedly pagan origins, old myths about the Inquisition that never seem to go away, or more modern errors that anti-Catholics put forth, The Real Story of Catholic History is an essential resource for every Catholic's bookshelf. Order your copy of The Real Story of Catholic History today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As the legend goes, the Protestant Reformation began when Martin Luther nailed a list of his grievances with the Catholic Church to the door of All Saints Church in Wittenberg, Germany. But do you know the whole story? In Catholic Answers' brand new documentary, The Protestant Revolution, you will hear from top apologists Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Carla Broussard, Trent Horn, and Steve Weidenkopf as they expose the errors of Martin Luther and of the other so-called reformers. This DVD will give you a clearer understanding of our Protestant brothers and sisters, and you will be better equipped to engage them about what separates us and about what unites us. Order your copy of The Protestant Revolution today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting shop.catholic.com, or by asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
EWTN, communicating the faith.
And I wanted to tell you guys how great your show is because I listen to you guys for every day for the last past 5.5 months. It's because of you guys that I came to the Catholic faith. Now I'm going to church on Sunday for the first time because I just got out yesterday from jail. And I got my mom to go too. And my girlfriend is also going with me. Wow. She's willing to give the Catholic faith a try.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. So happy to have you with us for this great big Wednesday show. And don't forget, tomorrow, 2 hours of open forum. We'll have Jimmy Akin here with us. I believe we'll have Patrick Madrid here with us. Unless I'm remembering the schedule wrong, it's going to be a wonderful. Any question you have on the Catholic faith is welcome during open forum, and you don't have to be Catholic to call. I also would like to remind you that all through the month of June, Catholic Answers Magazine, one of the finest Catholic publications in the world, and I don't make it, but I read it, and it is very, very good. Carlo's got a great article coming up in it on the hiddenness of God in the latest issue. And it's $10 off a one-year subscription, $20 off a two-year subscription. You get a free digital subscription thrown in with it. And you won't be sorry you did. The big Faith and Science issue comes out. That's the July-August issue. Lots of wonderful scholars talking about the relationship between faith and science and how Catholics, what the Catholic perspective is on that relationship. If you get your subscription in June, in addition to getting the $10 off on a one-year subscription and $20 off on the two-year subscription, you'll make sure to get the big faith and science issue coming out. You just go to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com. I have put off the callers because I really wanted to lay the groundwork so people would understand what we're talking about. When we're talking about Word of Faith, often called the Prosperity Gospel, Lisa, I feel that we have laid that groundwork. I would like to go to callers. You feel ready to take calls?
I'm ready.
Let's start with Walt in Pennsylvania. Walt, you are on with Lisa Cooper. Your question, please.
Yeah. How do these guys, how do they explain why the first apostles were all martyred? Why couldn't the apostles just name it and claim it and vaporize all these guys that were trying to kill them?
Yeah, that's such a great question, Walt. And that's one of the things that when I was in Word of Faith, I didn't really think about in those terms. I thought, oh, well, it's a great thing to die for your faith. And I think that's where these guys still draw that line. It's, you know, we shouldn't carry crosses and we have the right to walk in this great victory, except when it comes to being martyred for the faith. Oh. And so somehow they kind of, because that's a noble thing, and they believe that that's, I mean, they don't see martyrdom like we do as Catholics, because obviously they don't believe in the communion of the saints, but they do believe that we have to be able to have that fortitude to be able to be martyred for our faith. And so they really don't see that as, you know, something that the apostles should have done or that where they fell short. That's how they reconcile that, Walt.
Does that reconcile it for you, Walt, or are you? Go ahead.
If they're on the Nile River and ISIS was about to cut their heads off, they would say that's God's will for them. But other than that, it's not God's will to suffer.
Yes, and I know that doesn't make any sense because it's, you know, anytime you have a faith that's not grounded in truth, you're going to have all these loose ends that can't be tied up, that don't make any sense. And that is one of them. So you bring up an excellent point. But yeah, that's how they believe that yes, it's maybe not necessarily God's will. They never believe that it's God's will for you to suffer in any way, even for you to be martyred. But they believe that for you to become a martyr is a witness to the faith, that it's not a shortcoming on your part or a failure of your faith.
Oh, interesting. Okay, thanks for letting me know. I just was wondering how they could square that away. God bless.
Yeah, that's a tough one. Thank you, Walt.
Thank you very much, Walt. Appreciate that. And the weird twist that always strikes me about this, whether it's a New Age approach to the Word of Faith, you know, putting your word out to the universe, or a Christianized mm-hmm. version where you're, you know, claiming it in the name of Jesus or however mm-hmm. it's phrased in a different church, is it instead of that being a great liberation to the person, it becomes just a burden that you carry through mm-hmm. life. It's a trap. It's a trap gospel.
You know what? It's a constant tension is what it is. Because I mean, look at these preachers. who will come to you now and say, God told me I have to believe for a $54 million plane. So there's really never enough. There's really never that place where you exhale. It's always more. You always have to have more. And if I can just interject this real quick, when I was, I don't know, maybe in my 20s, there was a lady who came and spoke at our church, and she talked about these visions of heaven, that she had been to heaven. And she said that what she saw there were these rooms that were filled with all of these things that we didn't ask for on the earth. They were ours, and we didn't ask for them, and so we didn't get them. And so part of the thing that drives you in this is this idea that I don't want to show up before God, because we're really taught that this great weeping and gnashing of teeth isn't going to be over our sin. It's not going to be over our failings. It's going to be over all the things we could have had while we were on the earth, but we didn't.
Wow. I don't even know what to say to that. That's an extraordinary twist there. So
yeah.
Wow, I don't even, I'm gonna let the callers talk because I'm speechless at the moment. Lisa Cooper is our guest. Lisa is a Catholic and now a Catholic, raised in the Word of Faith or Prosperity Gospel Movement, knows all about it from the inside and the out, and we're happy to have your calls for her. April in New Orleans, you are on with Lisa Cooper. Your question, April.
Yes, my question is, I grew up as well, ever since a small girl, I'm 35 now, I grew up also under the prosperity gospel, and about 4 years ago, I was going through a separation and a divorce, and I went to my pastor at that time, and I asked him for counseling, and what we were told is that if you give $1,000 and you rely on your faith, then your marriage will be healed, and you would stay together. So ultimately, that did not happen, and I left the church. And I guess, right, what my question is, how do I help my parents and other family members to understand my rationale of, number one, why I did not pay the $1,000, and number two, why I left that denomination of church, and how do I help them understand what I see as I'm buying faith, or I'm buying the Spirit, I'm buying God.
Thank you, April. Lisa.
So, April, can I ask you, when you left the Baptist Church, or did you become another faith? Where are you now
I'm
in your
Catholic.
Walk with God?
Okay.
All right. So one of the things that I think I would approach with my parents is not necessarily, because people don't always necessarily understand a running from as much as they understand a running to. And so you can use that incident with $1,000, and that is prevalent all over Word of Faith. You know, the $58 seed will bring 58 promises into your life. A $1,000 seed will break the back of poverty in your life. And I can't tell you, girl, how many of those offerings I gave into myself. I was that person who cleaned out my savings account to give into an offering because I was told that it was going to bring this great blessing in my life, and it never manifested. So I think instead of trying to point to something that they still probably cling to as something that they believe pretty firmly, I would point instead to the truth of the faith, because you didn't just leave that church and become nothing. You came into the Catholic Church because you found truth, because you understood that truth was important. And one of the things that I have, you know, sort of peppered in my conversations with my family is God divorced from absolute truth is nothing more than a figment of our imagination. He is a mythological figure that is created to satisfy our need for the supernatural and to justify our actions, whatever they may be. But he's not God. And so if Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, then there has to be one truth and only one absolute truth. And that's what you found in the Catholic faith, April. And so I think what you can do is share what you found with your family. Share why you came home instead of why you left something that they still cling to. Because really, your heart is to convert your family, not just to explain your decision. And, you know, I mean, programs like, well, I mean, Catholic Answers exists because we know that we cannot evangelize people. You can't go to your parents and take them by the hand and look them tenderly in the eyes and say, Mom and Dad, this is crazy talk. You have to be able to give a defense of your faith, of why you came home, of the truth that you found. And I think that's going to do more good in convincing your parents than trying to go and put out every little fire of the Word of Faith, Prosperity Gospel movement, because you're never going to run out of them. But if you can point them toward the light, that's going to help them understand far better than pointing toward these areas where you were hurt.
April, what do you make of that?
I mean, I think that it's ironic that this is what you guys are talking about today, because this definitely for several years have been on my mind, and it actually has a line, a subtle line, but a line between my parents as well as myself. Mm-hmm. But what she says is phenomenal. That is where I realized once I got to the Catholic Church that I finally knew truly what that relationship with God should be. And that I don't need to be moved by emotion, and I don't have to pay for my faith and pay for my deliverance. God gives that to me freely. So
that's right.
Wow.
Basically, that's what I'm hearing from you, to continually encourage my parents in that way, instead of trying to explain to them, and that's what I typically do, try to explain to them why this does not make sense.
Mm-hmm.
April, what a beautiful testimony you just gave us, and I'm extremely moved by it. I think many people will be. It's not a faith you have to pay for; it's given free, and God loves you so much. I'm so grateful for you sharing that with us, April, and for your call. We got to take a break. Lisa Cooper is our guest. Lisa was raised in the Prosperity Gospel movement, has found her liberation in the truth of the Catholic faith, and wants to share it with everybody. We'll be right back to do more of that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, this is Archbishop Alexander Sample of the Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon. Keep that dial right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, my friends. Summer is here. That means summer reading. I have great news. Catholic Answers is having its first ever summer book sale in the online shop at Catholic.com. For a limited time, you can get dozens of great books offered at $10, $5, even as low as $1 a copy. Now is the time to load up on solid Catholic books for yourself, your friends, and your family. Save 50% or more on books by Jimmy Akin, Tim Staples, Rod Bennett, Gary Machuda, and a whole host of great authors. And my personal favorite, all the books in our Catholic Answers Classic series are marked down as well. Log on now and all this month to the store at shop.catholic.com and take advantage of our first ever summer sale. Log on today at shop.catholic.com.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
What difference does it make who or what you worship or what you believe? Sharing the faith used to make some people mad because it challenged their own strong beliefs. Today, it makes a lot of people yawn because they don't have strong beliefs about anything. Religious indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates modern culture. This is Matt Nelson, and in my new book, Just Whatever, I'll take down the building blocks of religious indifference one by one. We'll look at the different kinds of indifference you tend to encounter in your friends and family members to see where they come from and why they're seductive. What you believe matters. Find out why and what to do about it in my new book, Just Whatever. You can order your copy of Just Whatever by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're talking about the Word of Faith, often known as Name It and Claim It or Prosperity Gospel. And one of the striking things that April, the caller that just called, who gave a beautiful testimony about finding the true gospel of Jesus Christ, which liberates, which frees, and which calls us to something much higher and greater than ourselves. She talked about her parents living the prosperity gospel, and she called them Baptist. And that strikes me as a very interesting point, because to be a Baptist is not to believe in the prosperity gospel. And it's not
right.
that it's not that Baptists changed. It's that there are now the tentacles of the prosperity gospel. This is why it's important for Catholics to know this. They're mm-hmm. reaching into other churches so that you're still Catholic, but what you're believing is this prosperity gospel stuff that you hear Joel Osteen say or Kenneth mm-hmm. Copeland say, or maybe even a Catholic minister who's been infected with it. You were saying to me at the break when I mentioned that to you that there's we're very self-centered in modern society, and that's part of what makes this attractive.
Yeah, I mean, we are the center of our own world. We have become the center of what matters. And when you can know that when you listen to the reasons why people attend a particular church or leave a particular church, because what do they say? I like the mass, I like the homily here, or if it's a non-denominational church, I like the worship. It's I like, I want, I feel, I believe. And so it's become, our faith has become this sort of selfie faith. It's what do I look like? What does my reflection look like in this faith? Instead of where is the truth? Who does God say that he is? And what do I need to do to be transformed into his image? Instead, we very subtly are recreating him in our image. You know, when we hear Oprah Winfrey say things like, well, you know, the God that I know would never, you know, fill in the blank, you know.
Yeah, I hear that all the time, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But God is not, again, and it's kind of what April and I were talking about, if God is only the God that you make him out to be, then he's not God.
Right.
Then he's just this thing that you've created.
Right. As you said, to justify your own actions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Because then there's no such thing as sin is only what you believe sin is. It's not what God says sin is. And that's a very, you know, to use the lexicon, that's a slippery slope.
Yeah. I want to be very careful, and I know that you're careful about this, but that people don't think that we're saying that this is Protestantism, because there's a great diversity of Protestantism.
Right.
This is a strain that is infecting even Catholicism. All kinds of churches are being infected with this prosperity gospel idea.
Right, they are, because we are becoming more and more of a selfish people. And Word of Faith is, at its core, a self-centered faith. Now, most people in these even denominational churches that may have these traces of Word of Faith elements, no Baptist pastor is going to stand up and tell you that you're a little God. That's never going to happen. But if you believe that you can control your life because your words have power in and of themselves, that whole idea comes from the innate belief that you are a little God, whether you know that that's what that is or not. And so, no, you're exactly right. In fact, there are a lot of really great Protestant pastors who speak out vehemently and intelligently against the Word of Faith movement. So, no, I am not saying that this is, you know, if you're not Catholic, you're Word of Faith. I'm not saying that at all.
Indeed. Let's go to, we have another anonymous caller in an anonymous location. Anonymous, you are on with Lisa Cooper. Your question, please. That's you.
Hello?
Yeah, that's you.
I'm sorry. I haven't ever called in on a live radio station before. I just wanted to give you a quick background. I was in the Word of Faith up until 2009, and it had such a detrimental effect on me that I ended up leaving Christianity completely. And I'm fast forwarding ahead. When it got heavily involved in Law of Attraction, or The Secret, as you call it, which it actually ended me up in Wicca.
Recently
in April, had a miraculous encounter with the Holy Spirit and with the love of God, and thank God I've come back to where that I needed to be.
Praise God for that.
I live in a very, very small town. This is the only Christian radio station that I get, and I've been listening to it since April, and it's brought me to a place where I'm seriously considering attending the Catholic Church. It has had that strong of an effect in my life.
Well, you'll make it a lot better Catholic Church when you come in. We need you, Anonymous.
Amen. When I came in this evening, I had so many things to do, and the usual, I turn on the radio, and I heard Lisa, is her name? I heard what she was saying, and I literally sat down in my chair. I was like, I cannot believe I'm hearing this. It's like this woman is speaking about my life.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing the law of attraction take over so many lives, as well as the prosperity teaching. And there are, I can tell you from my experience, my study, there are direct lines between the two. Mm-hmm. Direct lines. And when I heard her talking about that, I got so motivated, and I'm kind of a shy person, and I said, I have to call, because my getting to my question is, what can you advise me to share with the friends that I have that I had before, you know, back in 09, that are still into prosperity teaching? What can I share with them to open their eyes, to help them see the correlation between the law of attraction and prosperity teaching?
I would tell you a couple of things. One is the fact that you have a background in Wicca probably serves you well in being able to explain to your friends the dark side of the law of attraction, because the law of attraction is witchcraft. And that's something that almost anyone in Word of Faith does not understand. Its roots are in witchcraft. So I can tell you, when you want to explain to your friends, first of all, I think I would tell them about my own experience if I were you. I think that's a great witness, and telling them. And in fact, Benny Hinn, you can probably find this clip on YouTube where Benny Hinn talks about the fact that a witch told him that they can kill birds with their words. And he said, and the Spirit of God talked to me, or told me, that we can speak life with our words. And so it's the same principle. In fact, Benny Hinn will tell you it's the same principle. So there are two things, Anonymous, that's very crucial to understanding the occultic roots of Word of Faith. In order for something to be occultic, O-C-C-U-L-T, part of the occult, it has to, number one, reside in the idea that there are spiritual laws and forces which can be manipulated in order to control the physical world, which from your background in Wicca, you're very familiar with that. The second thing is, it has to be based on the notion that somehow we are divine. And I don't mean in that we share in Christ's divinity in the sense that we are to share in his suffering and share in his humility and grow in virtue, but that we are divine in the sense that we have rights and we're going to use them to control the forces around us and get the things that we want out of life. And so you can go to your friends and explain this to them in terms of, this is the definition of the occult. You can talk to them, as I said, about your experience, but you can do a little bit of research if you want. There's a lot out there just on the New Thought movement, and that was kind of something that Cy and I were talking about. If you go in and find out how New Thought began, it came on the heels of the Transcendental Movement. It was kind of a turn-of-the-century movement. And really, New Thought was sort of centrally located, that idea, at Emerson College of Oratory, which is where E.W. Kenyon went to school, because he had left the ministry because he wanted a career on the stage. And while he may not have directly studied New Thought, it was the prevailing mindset of the entire place. Kenyon himself was very familiar with the teachings of Mary Baker Eddy. And so out of New Thought came all of what we call the Christian sciences. Okay, so Christian Science and any of the religious sciences that rely on this idea of using spiritual forces to affect change, to affect healing, to affect divinity. There's a lot of research that you can do if you want to on the New Thought movement and where it came from. But Kenyon himself was influenced by New Thought, and all he did was baptize New Thought teaching into a Christian lexicon. But he used those concepts. And so I'm not saying that your friends will listen to you, because they may not. But at least you can plant that seed. And then one other thing that I would encourage you yourself to research and also encourage your friends to research, and that is the history of the Bible. Because if you understand how the Bible came to us, that the Catholic Church predates the Bible, which Word of Faith people use as a sort of magical spell book almost. Like it, within the Bible, if you find any word or phrase, it doesn't even have to be in context, you can speak it and affect change. And they will use the Bible to criticize other faiths, specifically the Catholic Church. But if you could research and understand that the Bible came by the Holy Spirit through the Catholic Church, and that the Catholic Church actually predates the Bible, that we lived according to the tradition and the teachings of the apostles and their successors before we had this firm canon of scripture, that will also give them something to think about. Because Word of Faith is not just about, oh, I said these things. It's I said it from the Bible, and I know that the Bible is true, and I know where it came from. So you can kind of give yourself that something to think about as well.
Anonymous, we will have to leave it there because the music is playing and the music is the boss around here. Once it starts playing, we got to stop talking. Lisa Cooper, thank you so much. Is there somewhere where people can find you or read what you've written? Have you got a website or anything you want to give them?
I do. People can find me at lisagcooper.com. They can get in touch with me there, and at this point, I'm happy to answer their questions. I'm in the process of putting some pieces and articles together that people can kind of use as a ready reference for some of the questions like we had today.
And you got to write a book. We got to have the Lisa Cooper book. This is a net. You see why
I'm
said.
I'm working on it.
Okay, okay. That's what I wanted to hear. You're working on it. Back to work,
yes.
Lisa. The show's over. Back to work on that book. Thanks so much for being with us. Lisa Cooper is her name. And the prosperity gospel is the one to avoid. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.